Oh, yes.
Please keep your mobiles inside. Put it off. Yeah, good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to the Science Baha Lecture Series. My name is Ajay Dixit.
I'm a member of the Baha.
In fact, it's been a while. I haven't moderated a Baha lecture.
And then, as well,
Deepak said you haven't done Baha notice for a while. And then you've been working on climate change for a while, so therefore, come and do it. That was his instruction. I said, yes, of course. Particularly when, you know, we have someone like Dr. Byers to talk about his work. Now, let me take a few moments to just, you know,
tell about who is.
Yeah, of course, he needs no
introduction.
Someone who's spent his life studying about the
Alpine ecosystem,
lifestyle, livelihood in Himalayas. Conservationist, mountaineering,
specializing in climate research,
high altitude ecosystems, climate change, and development program. You had a photograph in Mount Everest, hasn't it?
Yeah. Comparison between, you know, the Kung Glacier then and now. So therefore, you know, for many of us who sort of, you know, came into climate change study a little later, you know, I'm an engineer by training. So I started talking about climate change in the mid-90s. And it started with a little bit of a sort of, you know, lack of understanding. Because I'm not a climate scientist, so my work was trying to understand what does climate change impact mean, you know, and how does society respond to changes. And the story in those days was Nepal need to adapt to climate change. And in my sort of, you know, limited understanding, Nepal is such a complex, diverse country. So how does Nepal adapt? What does that mean? So in the mid-90s, I started to begin to sort of unravel, unpack some of these questions. So my work is mostly on trying to figure out what does this changing climate mean in terms of the vulnerabilities created, and how do you adapt to it, and what does adaptation mean? And particularly after the 2015 earthquake, you know, one of the sort of very common, I would say, abused word is resilience. Everybody says resilient Nepal, resilient Nepalese, and, you know, everybody wants to become resilient. So trying to understand that for the last 15 years and still not very, still trying to do that, the quest continues. Anyway, here we have Dr. Baha telling us about his work in the Andes, and then telling us about, you know, the changes that's going on in the Alpine ecosystem path. So without further ado, let me hand over the floor to Right. We'll be speaking for half an hour, 45 minutes, and then later on we'll ask questions.
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay.
Thank you.
Okay, well, thank you very much. So it's been my privilege to work in a number of different capacities in Nepal since my first visit here in 1973 as an undergraduate. I've worked with the Makalukuruan National Park as co-manager for a couple of years. Worked for USAID up in the Mustang region on conservation projects. Did my master's in Muktinath, on Woods of Rye in Muktinath, and lived for a year in the Kumbu doing my PhD, which I'll be talking about today. For the last 10 years or so, I've been a little more focused on climate change. And let's see, how do we start? Do I use this or this for the? Oh, I know it. How about this? Yeah, okay. These are the two of the photo pairs that Ajaya is referring to. This is the Kumbu Glacier. I've been involved with a glacier lake risk reduction project called the High Mountain Adaptation Partnership. So it all started when I started replicating old historic photos like this of the Kumbu Glacier in 1955, taken by Erwin Schneider, and then showing the difference through the years of this lake, this glacier turning into a lake. That turned into the USAID-funded High Mountain Adaptation Partnership Project. That started out primarily to bring Peruvians together with Nepalese and other Asian engineers, because the Peruvians have like 50 years of experience in reducing the risk of dangerous glacial lakes in the Cordillera Blanca. But the main thing was this high mountain project was trying to integrate science, the research results we got from the lake, into the community consultation process so that people have the tools they needed to make informed decisions and informed plans. So this is continuing now through a new National Science Foundation grant we received in June when we were over here doing a post-earthquake assessment of impacts on glacial lakes. So that's exactly what I'm not going to talk about today. I'm going to talk about something different, another hat that I've worn through the years, which is community-based conservation and restoration of alpine ecosystems in tropical and subtropical high mountain regions. Now, this all started a year ago when I was asked by Routledge to write a chapter on restoration of alpine ecosystems for a new handbook, the Handbook of Ecological Restoration. And I said, okay, I'll do it, but this is going to be about tropical and subtropical alpine environments, because the processes of disturbance are quite different from those in the mid-latitudes. In North America and Europe, it's things like ski resorts and all-terrain vehicles and mining that disturb the alpine ecosystems, where in Nepal, Peru, East Africa, there are other processes that we'll look at today. First of all, alpine ecosystems take up about 3% of the Earth's surface, but they have about 10,000 flowering plants, okay, which makes them one of the most biodiverse ecosystems in the world per unit area, okay, according to Christian Kerner. So quite beautiful, quite diverse. They're important also for water. Most of the world depends on their water from the high mountain regions. Certainly people in Nepal and the subcontinent too, and in the Andes as well. They're gateways to sacred mountains, such as Machu Picchu here, which has in fact never been climbed. Colonel James Robertson got to within a few feet of the summit, and then he turned back upon agreement with the government of Nepal, because it's such a sacred mountain. In the Andes, to the Incan people, they were so sacred that they would routinely sacrifice young children, 6-year-old to 12-year-old, and bury them at the top of summits, 21,000 feet, 22,000 feet, which preserved them through the years. And about 20 years ago, they were discovered by Johann Reinhardt, which is who's pictured on the right there, the famous ice maiden. He's since discovered several more, some of them just absolutely perfectly preserved. The reason the Incas thought that the mountains were sacred was basically two reasons. Number one, that's where the Apu live, the gods. But number two, that they knew that's where they got their water. And water is very scarce in the dry Andes, and that's where their water came from, the mountains. Therefore, the mountains were worshipped. They're becoming increasingly important for tourism. Tourism continues to grow, trekking and mountaineering in high mountains around the world. In many cases, they're driving local economies and are therefore very important. So for example, here's a photo of Namche Bazaar in 1973 before the big tourist boom, and here it is a couple of months ago. Those are all new lodges. So you can see how important, how critically important tourism is to mountain economies. There are also grazing lands for countries all around the world, yaks, yamas, etc. They're sources of medicinal and edible plants and are very important for that reason. So let's start with the Khumbu. I just wanted to introduce the alpine ecosystems because for a number of reasons, especially economic, it's very important that we protect and preserve these ecosystems, some of which have been somewhat pummeled in the last 20 years with the rise of ecotourism, or what I call unregulated adventure tourism. This is the Khumbu region. It's the home of Mount Everest, of course. I'm sure you're all familiar that there are three main valleys in the national park, the Botikosi, the Dudkosi, and the Mjakola. It's a very rugged landscape, very beautiful high-altitude landscape, and the home of the Sherpa people. Now, what's interesting about the Khumbu, like I said, I lived there for a year in 1984 doing the research for my doctorate, and maybe many of you have heard about this so-called theory of Himalayan environmental degradation, okay, which was popular back in the 70s and 80s. Jack Ives has written a lot about it. Basically, what it said was that because of growing populations, the Nepalese hill farmers were cutting down all the trees, soil erosion was accelerating, soil fertility was decreasing, and new islands of silt were forming in the Bay of Bengal. And happened to be a very simplistic model, but it sort of caught the attention of the donor community for quite a while. Now the Khumbu was, I found, sort of a representative case study, a smaller case study of the theory of Himalayan environmental degradation, okay? In other words, people, it was funny how, if you review the literature, the people who had worked there sort of all jumped on the wagon and started saying things like, yes, more deforestation has occurred in the Khumbu in the last 20 years than the last 200 years. And other people were writing that whole hillsides of forests above Namche Bazaar are now gone. So I went over to quantify soil erosion as my thesis, and I fully expected to prove that the theory of Himalayan environmental degradation was true. Okay, why believe otherwise? Everybody said it was true, so it must be. But then, and resulting in hill slopes such as this, but then I started collecting evidence that suggested otherwise. And it started in the most unlikely of places, which is a soil profile. Now, next to my soil erosion plots, I would dig a soil profile to classify the soil. I just wanted to see what kind of soils were there, from Namche Bazaar all the way up to Dingoshe in the Alpine. And this is what I started finding. And this soil is called a podzolic paleosol. A podzol is that gray glade horizon that's created in a very moist environment when water infiltrates through the soil and leaches out the iron and aluminum oxides. Now this soil, this type of soil is formed under forest conditions. It's like this. This is, and you can see them today if you walk from Tengboshe down to Deboshe. Look at the trail cuts and you'll see these glade horizons. They form in very moist Ferberish rhododendron forest conditions, yet here's where I was finding them. Okay? So it suggested that at some time in the past there was a forest on this hill slope. And what we did very briefly was we took soil samples every 5 centimeters, analyzed them for pollen, collected the charcoal, dated that with C14, identified the charcoal species, and if you put it together, it told a different story. It said that there was a birch fir alder forest there about 2,000 years ago. It was there 1,500 years ago as well, but it started to open up, okay? You could tell that by the abundance of fern pollen that we found. There was an increase in fire, and then by 800 years ago, these hill slopes had been converted to shrub grasslands. In other words, when the Sherpa arrived in the Khumbu 500 years ago, they probably found landscapes that were quite similar to what we see today. Okay, they did not find a completely forested landscape that they proceeded to modify to create pastures. People were coming there thousands of years ago, we think, and converting the south-facing forests into grasslands. And the Sherpa have stories about certain buildings being the artifacts of the Rai people. So who knows, maybe the Rai were coming up 2,000 years ago. And I've done these analyses all the way from Tame up to Loboche, and they pretty much tell the same story. In some cases, there's evidence that people were there 5,000 years ago. So that's a little different from what conventional wisdom was saying. Another method is repeat photography. You take the photographs of the older cartographers or climber scientists to a region, like Erwin Schneider on the far right, the guy with the really, really great hair. This is Erwin in the 1930s. He was part of the German-Austrian mountaineering cartographic expedition in the Cordillera Blanca of Peru. And then in 55, he came to the Mount Everest area to make the beautiful Alpenbergskart map. So I would take his photos and go back to the photo point. That's Namche Bazaar in the lower left. So if there were forests there in 1950, as were being claimed, I don't see them, okay? And then I took it again in 1995, and yeah, you can see some growth in the village and maybe some thinning above the Shangoche airstrip, but not to the extent as was claimed. If you look back at that arrow, it's pointing to a torrent. A torrent is like a gully that periodically floods from heavy rainfall or snow melt. There were claims that this was related to recent grazing, overgrazing, and that this was a new feature. And yet, it was there, not only in the 50s, but when I studied it, back in, when I was living in the Khumbu, there are a series of levees to each side of it. It's a very, very old feature. It's hundreds of years old. So again, we got some overstatements. What I did find, however, was sort of a good news story. This is the Tangoche Hill in 1955, taken by Fritz Muller, another glaciologist, and here it is again, recently. You can see a pretty significant increase in trees, both to the right as well as to the left. Why has there been this increase? It's probably related to a number of factors that include changes in land use, changes in livestock use. Some people claim that the traditional Shinganawa system never really died out, that they were continuing to manage their resources well. The National Park, new policies by the National Park could have played a role, and climate change. Okay, it's gotten warmer, maybe that's more conducive to tree growth. But we've seen this greening of the Khumbu, which is interesting. I think that the reason people were making some of these overstatements in the 70s and 80s is that they would visit the Khumbu in March or early April, when landscapes look like this. They look quite dry, quite eroded. But if you stay there the whole year and you spend a summer there, you can see that by May, you have a continuous cover of vegetation on these same hill slopes. So then when you get even heavy, high-intensity rainfall, you're getting no process. You're getting no, very little soil erosion. And that was back in 84. If you look at it a couple of months ago, look how those landscapes have changed. Those exclosures above Namche Bazaar are filled with native trees now. Mendafu Hill is now covered in trees. It was actually covered in trees by the mid-90s, but they were all cut down during the insurgency by the army, who were afraid of being attacked. So again, a very significant change in the Khumbu landscape. So I got no soil erosion on the south-facing shrub grasslands, no evidence of soil erosion on the north-facing forests, but up in the Alpine, my traps were constantly filled with sediment, even though precipitation is only about 400 millimeters per year. That's a quarter of what you get down in Namche Bazaar. So something was going up that I didn't quite understand. I went back to repeat photography as a first tool. This is the Dingboshe hill slopes in 1955, and again in the late 90s. Looks like maybe there's some evidence of some loss of vegetation. Hard to tell. We do know that Dingboshe has grown significantly as a result of tourism, just like Namche Bazaar. Here's the town, here's the photo by Bruce Jeffries, taken in 77, and here's another photo in 2010, taken by Rodney Garrard. So again, tremendous change in the landscape. Did this have something to do with the devegetation of the hill slopes. So finally, I went back on a National Geographic grant and made dozens of transects throughout the Alpine, sort of using a systematic belted transect approach, 5 by 5 meter plots every 20 meters or so up the hill slope, and collected a range of variables such as percent cover, shrub cover, bare ground, but also number of cut stems or cut shrub, juniper, etc. And what we found is that when you average the data, you get about an average of 40% recent loss of shrub, juniper, and that's what was leading to this degraded appearance of the hill slopes in the area. And what was happening then, it was clear, it was the lodges. Now, this is back in 2001, but back then, lodges, everybody was starting to build lodges in Dingboshe, Veriche, Deboshe, Borakshep. And since it was expensive to bring wood up from lower down, they were ripping out the shrub juniper and burning that. Every lodge in Dingboshe had stacks of shrub juniper like this. Can you, if you can see that cutoff piece, that squared piece, I sampled that and I sent that up to the Columbia Tree Ring Lab. It came back with an age of 250 years, okay? So it takes a long, long time for these alpine shrubs to grow. And ripping them out, sometimes, you know, you're disturbing things forever. Now, this has been going on for a long time. This is a photo from Fritz Muller in 56, on the way up to the, with the Swiss Everest expedition. That clearly looks like shrub juniper to me. But densities, population densities were so low back in the 50s and the 60s that it really had no impact. It was later on in the 90s and 2000 with the tremendous growth in tourism that we started seeing impacts on these alpine ecosystems. So here's another picture of a lodge. This happens to be in the Hinku Valley that we'll go to in a moment. And it wasn't just the shrub juniper, but if you look at the alpine cushion plants, okay? Alpine plants have different ways of protecting themselves. It can be covering themselves with a cottony type substance, such as the Sauceria off to the left, or low growth to the ground. These are arid area. It takes about 10 years to grow 1 millimeter. Okay? And yet people, we found, were digging these up, drying them, and burning them in the lodges. So clearly there were some unsustainable land use practices going on in the Alpine at this time. Also, turf harvesting is another very detrimental process. Alpine soils are covered with about a 10 centimeter thick layer of turf. It's combined with millions of fine roots and fine soil, and that protects the very thin alpine soils. Once you dig it up, which is commonly done to use for building walls or for patios in lodges, you're exposing those very thin, fragile soils and getting accelerated soil loss. Now, what you're doing altogether is removing the structural diversity that was securing the soils to these steep slopes. So as opposed to the diagram on the left, which could be representative of hill slopes near Namche, which have got these nuts and bolts sort of holding the soil in place, and Dingboshe looked more like the figure on the right, where so much of it had been removed, and we had accelerated soil erosion processes as a result. Next step was to share our results with local people, conduct a series of community consultations, and really thanks largely to Angrita Sherpa from the formerly of the Mountain Institute in 2004, with financial assistance from the American Alpine Club, the local lodge owners formed the Khumbu Alpine Conservation Council. And the first thing they did was to stop the cutting, the harvesting of all shrub juniper, saving something like, even just for Dingboshe alone, that's something like 17,000 kg of shrub juniper per season. So you can imagine how much was being mined throughout the entire Khumbu, and they stopped it, okay? We had nothing to do with it. We shared our results with them. They stopped it. We helped them also get additional funding from UNDP as well as the Argosy Foundation, and they built their own office building and community center. They worked with the park to enforce the new regulations not to harvest the shrub juniper. They renovated a building to become a porter's shelter, because at least 10 years ago, at the end of the day, most trekking companies would abandon their porters. Porters were left to fend for themselves. So what would they do? They would find a cave, go sleep in the cave, but they would burn the juniper and the dwarf rhododendron for fuel to keep warm. So they were part of the problem, not that it was their fault. But here they had a warm place to sleep, they had food to eat, so that decreased the pressure on the land. They started their own kerosene depot. These days there's a heavier reliance on solar. Solar is everywhere, and there's talk of hydropower being introduced to take us away from fossil fuels. Now, let's flip back to where I come from in West Virginia. This is the Blister Swamp. This is a project I worked on with the Nature Conservancy about 10 years ago. This particular high altitude swamp contains an amazing number of globally rare plants, but they have been pummeled for 150 years by the cattle that my friend's great-great uncle after the Civil War bought and grazed for 150 years, or started grazing. As a result, Blister Swamp was called dead by the 1980s, and yet a botanist went there, took a look at it, said, no, these plants are still there. They're hiding. You just have to protect them. So we built this fence, 7,000 feet of fence, and look at compare the two photos. Okay. Yeah, it'll come to you, come on in a moment. You can see a tremendous change in the vegetation just as a result of protecting from cattle as well as from deer. And I really fell in love with exclosures, so I wanted to test this exclosure theory up in the Dingleshade. That's where we are right now. Any questions so far?
No.
Manohari, ask me a question. Yes.
You mentioned the porter shelter that was built.
Yes.
Yeah. Warm place for them to stay.
Right.
They keep warm with kerosene, or what were they keeping warm?
Well, with blankets.
No fire or anything.
Well, they had a fire.
Out of dwarf juniper.
No. Wood brought up from the forest, the dead wood brought up from below. I mean, they're still using, to a certain extent, the dead wood from the forest down by Dingleshade, the fir, birch, rhododendron forest. You know, they have an annual harvesting season, they have a quota where everybody can harvest so much. They have their own harvesting areas. You know, Kumtung owns this, Kundi owns that. And they are still burning yak dung. You see a lot of people burning yak dung and collecting yak dung during the day. So I'm not saying there's no energy, no energy problems there anymore. I mean, as we'll see in a moment, if this comes on again, oh good, that there are still other problems to contend with. So anyway, I just loved exclosures, and I said, look at how the plants came back. These globally rare plants, there were just a handful of them before the project, and they came back in the thousands after that. It's just an amazing, successful project. So we decided to try this exclosure idea above Dingleshade, and I'm sorry to say that it failed. I went back just a few months ago, resampled the plots, the transects inside, and basically what happened is those slopes are so disturbed, they're so degraded, that it's just so difficult, for the vegetation to come back again. Okay, so that's the lesson learned, is that prevention is better than cure, okay? Especially when you get into alpine ecosystems. And they started their own nursery, which was recently taken over by partners in Nepal. What really impressed me, though, was that on their own, For decades, there's been a practice at the Everest base camp of climbing expeditions burning tons of shrub juniper every year as a puja. Okay, it's part of the puja to the gods. And I thought that's something that would just plain go on forever. You know, because it's something cultural and it's something that's part of the climbing expedition. But about 6 years ago, they put a stop to it. The KACC stopped the burning of, you know, huge quantities of shrub juniper at the Everest base camp, substituting incense instead. That was a pretty remarkable achievement.
How did that happen?
What's that?
The stopping of burning of junipers.
Oh, they just got together. They got the park, to support them, and they talked to the mountaineering groups, and it's no longer done.
They understood that because the too much cutting was sort of, you know, degrading the landscape.
I think everybody, once you show them the data, once you show them the proof, everybody understands that loud and clear, because that's their bread and butter. That's how they're making their living. And you know that, so you want to preserve that goose. Okay? Now, I'm not saying that there are no problems. For the last couple of years, I've noticed there's an increasing number of landfills. Now, solid waste is coming in and it's not going out. Okay, and it's ending up in landfills, so-called burnable garbage, which is burning everything, plastic bottles and anything that gets in there, which is very toxic, and it's contaminating the groundwater, just exacerbating the contamination problems we're having in the Kumbu now. That others are related to leaking septic tanks. For example, in Namche Bazaar, you can't drink the water because of so many lodges, or poorly situated outhouses. But that's a real problem to confront. I think we need to find ways to provide incentives to the lodge owners to recycle and to ship out what is being brought in, because this is really terrible for the water, for the landscape, for the health of animals and people. Likewise, I found that up at the Everest Base Camp, you've got about 12,000 pounds of human waste generated every year. They do a good job of it. They collect it in these barrels. But then, what do they do with it? I found they take it down, they dump it into pits, which are right in seasonal watercourses. So when the rain comes, it's being all washed down. That's why everybody's getting sick, you know, on the Everest Base Camp trek these days. So let's go to the next case study. This is the Hinku Valley in the Matalupurun National Park. This is the village of Kote. It was a Maoist base of operations during the insurgency, so they actually encouraged local people from Bung and Chesdam to build lodges and structures in the interest of generating income. So by the time we got there, there was quite a bit of loss of forest that we noticed, as well as, you've seen this slide before, the beginnings of tourism, lodge building up in Tognog and in the other Alpine areas, and the burning of shrub juniper, just like they had been doing in the Khumbu region. So we basically replicated the Khumbu project of the transects, measuring the amount of wood being used, sharing the information with local people, and they formed in 2009 the Mara Alpine Conservation Group, which basically did had similar actions to the KACC in stopping the cutting of shrub juniper. I went back and resampled these transects a little while ago and was very pleased to see how quickly this ecosystem is restoring itself. I think the reason why is because we caught it. We caught it before it went too far, okay? Also, the Hinku Valley is much wetter than the Khumbu, and things are a bit more resilient. So that's another very positive experience. Now let's go to the third case study, the Cordillera Blanca in Peru, and that's the city of Huaraz. And like Nepal, it has become a very popular tourist destination, especially for mountaineering and for climbing. As opposed to Nepal, there are no trekking peak fees or no climbing fees, so thousands and thousands of climbers go down there from Europe and the US every year. Now, what we found when we were looking at the impacts of alpine ecosystems there was something a little different from what we found in the Khumbu. The main culprits are cattle, okay? It's a national park, but the Spaniards brought cattle over in the 1700s, and now cattle are firmly a part of the campesino way of life, the Quechua way of life, that and agriculture. So you can be camped at 5,000 meters and unzip your tent in the morning and there's a cow looking at you. They're just absolutely everywhere. The second thing is there are no porters. They don't use porters in the Andes. They use donkeys, okay, burros, and arrieros, or the donkey drivers. So they'll take the equipment of the climbers up to the base camp, you can see in the back, let the burros go to graze for the night, and they have such sharp hooves that we found that they were the culprits. They were the ones that were causing the damaged soil, damage to the soils and to the vegetation. So what we did was a little different than what we'd done in Nepal. We developed conservation contracts with the local villages. In other words, we helped them and funded for them the building of enclosures with improved grassland. In exchange for them bringing the cattle down from the alpine and grazing them here around the villages. And it worked. I resampled those plots in 2010 and found that the grasslands up high that had been so severely disturbed 10 years ago had been almost fully recovered. So there's one more technique we used. Finally, this is the Barun Valley. I was there back in 2013. We went out on a National Geographic grant to look at impacts of contemporary impacts on the alpine ecosystem there. And I was there in about 20 years ago when I was working for Makalu Burun. And at the time, in the Burun, during the Makalu base camp, the same things that were happening in the Khumbu were happening. In other words, tourism was growing. Lodge owners were cutting down the juniper. So just like the theory of Himalayan degradation, I was convinced that, okay, I'm gonna go in, I'm gonna find the same thing that I found in the Khumbu, and maybe we'll form a committee, and hopefully that will help. And once again, I was wrong, because in 20 years, many things had changed in this valley. Well, first of all, it's a very different region. You've got at least six different vegetation zones from tropical to subtropical to oak rhododendron to fir birch rhododendron, and then the alpine. It's known for its welcoming committees everywhere you go. But we had, and here, what we found is one of the best books I've ever read is called The Arun. It was by Ed Cronin, written back in 1970 about his year with Jeff McNeely studying the wildlife in the Indus region. And one part of his book said that it was July and he was spending a lot of time trekking up here to the Burun, and he noticed he was getting a suntan. And the reason he was getting a suntan is because it looked like this in June and July. You're above the base of the monsoon. Yeah, sure, it rains every now and again, but by and large, you get these beautiful, beautiful days, and the best of all worlds, the wildflowers, the beautiful weather, etc. So normally people don't trek in the monsoon, but that's what had made us decide to go ahead and trek in July up here. But what I had thought of was there'd been a civil war in the interim, okay? It'd been 10 years, and all the infrastructure that we had built in Makalu Burun had been destroyed. There had been the process of out-migration, so that many villages now, as you well know, consist of young children and older people. It was reported to us that because of out-migration, there was a shortage of manpower, and that was leading to a decrease in livestock populations. I can't prove that, but that's what we were told, because they just no longer have people to manage the herds. And of course, 11 years ago, Yarsugumba was discovered, the cordyceps, that very curious sort of a mummified larva of the ghost moth that then grows this stomata that then sticks out of the earth and then people harvest, and it's very, very valuable. The high quality Yarsuk Gumba can fetch like $50,000 per kg in Beijing. So these days, apparently about 5,000 young boys go up and harvest Yarsuk Gumba between May and July. Okay, so that was an impact that we just didn't anticipate. Tourism impacts were quite small, actually. Yeah, they're building some new lodges up there, but they're just that still not that many tourists that go back to the Burun Valley. And here's what was happening. It wasn't mountaineers doing this, okay? It was the young Yarsuk Gumba harvesters, because now they have so much money that they can pay people to bring beer and whiskey and Heineken and everything else, okay? And what happens to it, it's just like in the Kumbu, it ends up in a landfill. And this, you know, I never would have believed you would see this way back in the Yangwe Karka. Piles of beer bottles like this, you know, that we used to blame on the mountaineers, are now have a more local cause. We're going back in 3 weeks on a new geographic grant to now look at what the impacts are on the environment. Now, the socioeconomic impacts of Yarsuk Gumba are fairly well documented in the literature, but I haven't seen that much that talks about impacts on the environment, and that's what we're going back to find out. We have heard that there have been significant impacts on birds, on bird life. One, people would tell us, you know, you don't hear birds anymore, do you? And that's because young boys like slingshots, and slingshots are not good for birds. The good news story is the snow leopard. The snow leopard is coming back, just like it is in the Kumbu. And we'll continue also our studies of potentially dangerous glacial lakes. This is the lower Burun that's especially dangerous based on our studies of a potential glacial lake outburst flood because it's directly overhead peak 6 and peak 7. So ice can cascade, it does cascade on a daily basis into the lake, possibly creating a surge wave. Just like what happened in the Lagmoshe flash flood in 1985 in the Kumbu, which killed a number of people and destroyed a hydropower plant. So this is only going to get more and more dangerous as the years go by and that glacier calves back to the hanging glacier. You can see that white thing in the background. It's going to be directly under ice. And here's just a diagram of how it's grown over the years. So to recap, alpine restoration methods in the mid-latitudes, hopefully they're science-based, but they're largely government-driven. It's the Forest Service or Fish and Wildlife Service that implements the projects. They're largely related to mining and drilling or ski resorts, and they use techniques such as reseeding, soil fertilization, turf transplanting, or biodegradable geotextiles. As opposed to in the tropics and subtropics, again, we hope it's science-based, but success seems to be more community-driven. Impacts are related to largely to unregulated adventure tourism, alpine shrub harvesting, more recently, we think, to new markets, especially for like Yarsuk Gumba, and community-determined behavior and land use changes are the most effective methods of dealing with them. As I mentioned before, prevention is much more effective than cure. It can take hundreds of years to restore some of these hill slopes, if they ever restore. Some are beyond restoration. And as I mentioned, a range of new problems remain that are in need of solutions, like human waste. You know, can we develop solar composting systems to take care of human waste, solid waste? Can we develop incentives for recycling instead of putting it into the ground. Energy, of course. I've always felt that visitor and service provider awareness building will be key to finding solutions, but I also think we need to mobilize the international community more. We need to mobilize the climbing clubs, the gear manufacturers, they're the ones making all this money off of sleeping bags and tents and everything. And, you know, they don't have to become directly involved, but they should be making funds available to groups like the Khumbu Alpine Conservation Council to support their work, or to the Mara Alpine Conservation Council. And globalization and climate change are creating new unanticipated challenges. My example was the case of the Burun Valley and the impacts of Yarsuk-Lumba harvesting. And if you want further information, my chapter in the Handbook of Ecological Restoration will be available from Routledge sometime in the next several months. And that's it. So thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Byers. I think it was an excellent sort of encapsulation of what we have done over the last several years. Seems to me one of the key lessons is the importance of sort of, you know, in some way doing an area study, and sort of consistently and continuously looking at the nature of the problem and kind of, you know, teasing out, you know, what's the chance that's going on. Now this is a fundamental lesson for the kind of research we do in Nepal at the moment. You know, the duration is maximum of the project funding cycle, it's about 3 years. You go collect data and then you come back and say, hey, we have the evidence, and then you try to present the policy prescriptions, which doesn't work, which is kind of very sort of significantly, as you highlighted, that the evidence is important. And what I also find very interesting is, you know, as I try to work on issues of climate change, you know, the question is, which is the dominant driver? Is it climate change, or it is, you know, some other processes going on? As you have very rightly sort of highlighted, you know, there are other kind of dynamics going on. The changes in land use, the entry of tourism, you know, the last 15 years of sort of, you know, socio-political change, migration, including, you know, Yarsuk-Lumba essentially triggering a different kind of, you know, behavior. So lots and lots of lessons, ladies and gentlemen. I will sort of, you know, come back to that a little later. But then the question, sorry, the floor is now open for questions. Please raise your hands, introduce yourselves. Please be specific to the point. We'll take about 3 questions to answer, and then we'll come back. Right? Yeah.
My name is Dhruva Acharya. I'm a forester by profession. So thank you very much for bringing the whole high mountain to this room, because it's so difficult to reach there. You know, for many of us, it's very difficult to reach there. And for me, you know, this forest degradation in high altitude is not a recent past phenomenon. It's more than 800 years old. It's quite interesting for you, and it's quite intriguing for me as well. You know, I'm very interested to know that more. One thing, I have one question is, transhumance grazing is a part of alpine ecosystem. Yeah. And somehow in your presentation, you didn't mention about the transhumance grazing. So can I know why you missed that very important part of the alpine ecosystem? Just I'm curious to know. Mm-hmm.
I did have that slide that showed the yak and the fact that alpine ecosystems are important for us. And yes, the alpine ecosystems throughout Nepal continue to be used for grazing. But like I said, what I found in the And what we found in the Burun is that, just like in the Khumbu, there are changes in grazing as well. In the Khumbu, they may be related to the fact that it's more profitable to have pack animals, to have yaks, than it is to have Tsokyo or Chowdy, you know, milk-producing animals. And the Sherpa people are getting away from that. They're no longer making cheese. They're no longer making the amounts or using the amounts of milk they used to. And then in the Burun, we saw, of course, other dynamics affecting livestock. But yeah, you're entirely right. They're very important for livestock and grazing. Mm-hmm. Transhumance.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Actually, we are very grateful to you for this beautiful work you did for the sake of conserving Because
the environment.
I have two small curiosities. When you said we, which institution or which organization do you mean? I ask this because as I pointed out, which Nepalese agency, governmental, non-governmental, are you collaborating closely so that the knowledge that you have gathered becomes embedded in the Nepali institution? So that's very important. Like he said, so much of research goes on and on and on. It's very, very hurting. So that is my first curiosity. And second curiosity is, of course, with respect to the first aspect, you said there were some local institutions you were involved. Mm-hmm. My second curiosity is now, the state of management in Nepal is, because the government is not functioning, there's not an institution. Now, the benefit of your works will be sustained and enhanced and quickened if there were responsible government institutions to coordinate with you, to gather the energy, to save it into a body of knowledge. Mm-hmm. What do you see as existing government policy, government laws and government practices? Mm-hmm. If you have contact with our politicians, how do you read their sensitivity towards issues like this? Thank you.
Yeah, thank you. Well, the first question was, I'm sorry, I forgot to mention this. I did mention Anurita Sherpa, and I was working with the Mountain Institute at the time. Okay, in fact, I worked 25 years for the Mountain Institute, which has an office here. And our main Nepal partner was the Department of National Parks and Wildlife Conservation. So we worked with them for years to help set up the Makalupura National Park, and then on these projects directly involved the National Park and the Alpine Conservation projects. In terms of institutions, again, I think it would take a focused effort to build the capacity of the most appropriate Nepalese institution, which would most likely be the Department of National Parks and Wildlife Conservation. It reminds me of the experience I had with the Lapa. We worked 2 years in the Khumbu researching Imja Lake, okay, getting good data about Imja Lake. How big is it? How deep is it? How much water does it have? How dangerous is it? And we shared that with the local people and developed a local adaptation plan of action. Okay. My regret is that the donor gave us the funds to develop a plan, but they didn't give us the funds to implement any of the interventions to bring the whole project to full cycle. So just sharing information is not enough. I mean, I can share this, and I do routinely share this with my Nepali colleagues, but to share it with the Department of National Parks, for example. But I think you'd have to have a stronger mechanism in place, have the funding in place to actually go up and get deeply involved in these questions I raise. How do you take care of solid waste? What are you going to do about the contamination? Okay, how well is the Khumbu Alpine Conservation Council working? So I think we need to be realistic about this. It's, sharing information is good, but there's nothing like nuts and bolts to get things done.
Thank you. Myself Nawaz Bara. I'm also a forester, but working. I'm very much interested in high altitude. I have some studies since last 22 years. Okay. I work in Sipulpanthu, Dwaraha, Ramisa, and also Kwata. Thank you very much. You have written very, very good articles. I have read each and every recent one also. I could not come earlier in the beginning. So my question is that So far the reports, publication and forest inventory, all other shows that forest of Nepal, especially in the high altitude and high Himalaya, have been improved by quality, by area. My small research, extensive research says no, that is just completely reversed. And your case study, your article are so good, so realistic, so excellent, based on facts and figure, nobody rely on that or take care of those studies. So what do you think? These are the scenarios. The scenarios of the mostly conservative national parks of Nepal. What would have happened in other areas? Okay, 40 to 45% of the Nepal is now under protection area. And there are number of separate state islands governed by each their own norms and values. Who don't know why it is there. And number of INGO and NGO working over there. You just told, you share your information and findings to the people. But the question is, who are the listeners? What is their power? So that's why we have to again to the decision makers. We are all interested here. I'm trying, and myself, we are two some of the persons who always talk about high altitude, and the last month is another thing. So that's why one thing. Another thing, I just want to 5 minutes after this break. I want to publish your piece and every articles in Nepal. If you give me permit, I will do that. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
Yeah.
Yeah, thanks very much for the question. I mean, I can really only speak primarily about the Khumbu because I've worked in the Khumbu. In fact, my new book will be coming out in a few months. It's called Change, 60 Years of Culture, Climate, and Landscape Change in the Sagar Martha National Park. It's basically a collection of some of the photos you've seen, the old glacier photos of the climber cartographers, the photos of landscape photos of Erwin Schneider that I've repeated over time, so you can see changes in the cultural landscape. I think the Khumbu has definitely been a success story, but I can't speak to the other areas because I haven't done that level of research. But it's a very good question. You know, who reads these publications? You know, who are the listeners? Certainly academics, read the publications, but somehow we have to get this information into a form that's accessible to the policymaker as well, okay, and to the program implementer. So there, that's the challenge. It's finding out, as people have repeatedly said, how do you get this information to the appropriate audience? That's a challenge. But thank you.
Get that.
This is Manubhadra Khatri. I'm anthropologist, and I'm very much privileged to listen to your very interesting talk today. And you have a very comparative approach to high this environment issue of Alpine environment. And I'm very much impressed that you also talk about out-migration, yeah? And I think you talk about Nepal. And is this a similar case in Andes also, or how it is? And can we consider them as environmental refugee, or there are other factors which contribute them to migrate outside? Thank you.
Yeah, thanks very much. That's a really good question. Because as a matter of fact, out-migration from the mountains is very high in the Andes, okay? Okay, and it's for the same reasons as in Nepal and for mountain countries in general, historically, it's for economic reasons. They don't have the economic incentives to stay, so that's why we're seeing, you know, this out-migration pattern.
Out-migration,
yeah. So it's a pattern we've seen all over the world. I'm over here as a Fulbright specialist. I just finished lecturing for 3 weeks at Tribhuvan University, and my first lecture was mountains and people. Okay, and mountains have similarities all over the world, and they're similar in terms of, you know, ecosystems and vegetation, but also in terms of people. People tend to be poorer in mountains, and they tend to out-migrate a lot more in mountain regions than they do in lowland. So, yeah, that's a fact of life for high mountain regions.
Hi, my name is Steve LeClaire. I'm here with Johns Hopkins University School of Public Health, but I've always been very interested in natural history as well. A number of years back, I lived out in East Nepal, in the Arun Valley, Sungpa Sabha, Taplejung area. And 2 or 3 years ago, I went back with some old friends from Taplejung, and we went up into the northwestern Taplejung area. And I'm bringing this up because you're talking about how much tourist lodges use dwarf juniper, dwarf rhododendron for fuel, and they're affecting the ground cover as a result. But in that particular area, the northwestern Taplejung, there's virtually no tourists at all. And we went up and saw just like a continuous stream of chowri trains coming down. People had been up cutting dwarf juniper, dwarf rhododendron, dubisumpati, and bringing it down. And they were, that was one of their major sources of income, because the road had come up to a certain point below Taplejung Bazaar. They could take their chowri trains down that far and sell as much as they could, take it out by truck. Mm-hmm. So I think that in non-tourist areas, I don't know about Sindhupalchok or Dolaka or anywhere like that, but I think it might be going on as well. They use that then for incense, either like raw incense or making stick incense too. So that might be interesting to look into in non-touristed areas of the Alpine areas, see how much degradation is going on because of that. And you can really see the difference when we crossed over into the Kanchenjunga Conservation Area. There were whole hillsides, hill slopes, mountain slopes covered with juniper and sunpati, dwarf rhododendron. And it was a big change from a little bit farther to the west where it was not in the conservation area. That might be something to add to your list up there.
Yeah, no, that's really interesting. But, you know, it's one big detective story, okay? Every valley is different. And I focused on the tourism, the valleys hit by tourism. But then I also have the Burun, which has other factors going on, which I think are related to Yarsugumba. You bring up an excellent point of, in other valleys, there are new markets because of the road, and they're harvesting the sunbati and the dwarf rhododendron and the juniper for incense. I mean, there's a master's thesis right there. There's somebody's PhD, and that, you know, that's a serious problem. But, you know, it kind of reminds me of glacial lakes, you know, and the risks of glacial lakes. I hate to keep coming back to them, but one thing I've learned is everyone is different, okay? So everyone is going to take a different prescription to reduce its risk. And I think we've sort of teased that out today. Every one of these, you know, there are many different things going on in Nepal's high valleys. I think my point, and you're bringing up an excellent point, is even the most remote of high mountain valleys are now being changed. And they're being changed by different factors, okay? Largely markets and roads. And, you know, I didn't expect that. I don't think you expected that when you went up. But isn't it a joy when you do go over that crest and you see a continuous cover of dwarf juniper, just like it used to be, you know, 100 years ago. But, yeah, thanks for the question.
Any more questions, friends? I could ask you one.
Sure.
I mean, continuing with the question now, hills are beautiful, city, you know, you enjoy, but life is hard. You have to walk up and down. So therefore, people look for, you know, roads. And then there's a sort of extensive process of road building going on. Even in the Khumbu area, Solu has already a road that connects. It takes about 8-9 hours to get there. Now, how do you envision, given the sort of, you know, political transition, sort of a very weak government, you know, sort of a lack of resources, culture, so on and so forth, how would that play out with the kind of, you know, sort of phenomena process that's ongoing, penetration of market, road being built? How would the, you know, Alpine ecosystem sort of reconcile or deal with it? How do you envision that?
No, that's a very good question. I mean, roads are here, and you know, more are coming. Hydropower is coming. You know, I'm a big advocate of using Peru's, I'm getting back to glacial lakes again for a moment, but Peru's 50 years of experience to develop Nepal-specific methods of lowering glacial lakes so they're no longer dangerous. And they're safe. And safe is defined as if there's a flood, nobody dies, and hydropower plants are not destroyed. But you know, a lot of people don't. It's hard to convince them of that. So roads are coming in, and there, as a result, there are changes. I think it's up to us to monitor those changes. Okay, as I've been trying to do with the Burun Valley, as Steve pointed out, you know, for eastern Nepal. You know, we need to monitor those changes, and there has to be a responsible party, Department of National Parks or the Forest Service, that, you know, is able to act. Okay.
I think it's a very good point. If you don't have any more questions, Deepak, you can. Yeah. Well, let me take a few more minutes to sort of tease up a few lessons from what you said. I think, as I said, you know, a lot of examples for a lot of us working on research around natural resource management and climate change. We try to grapple with some of the sort of conceptual difficulties, you know, whether it's the climate triangle, whether it's the other way, the socio-political changes, which is exacerbating vulnerabilities both in the natural ecosystem as well as livelihood. Yet, what you presented here sort of underscores the need for, you know, sort of systematic, continuous research, that evidence is really important. You know, what you generate as fact is important. And now those facts actually help you to think about policies. In your particular case, you know, the target where the local community where you went back, sort of shared your findings, and then were able to come out with, you know, sort of the ways of dealing with the sort of, you know, ongoing negative changes. Now, that is important, the whole idea of going back and sharing, and then generating a shared understanding, I think is very, very central. At the same time, you know, simply information is not going to help. You need some tangible kind of, you know, sort of outcomes. I mean, that's the question we're also asked. Right, you come here to collect data, you do this, all that, fine. You know, you teach us a little bit about climate change, so on and so forth. Great, but what next? You know, how do you sort of, you know, begin to operationalize that tangibility? How do you make it more tangible? That's a sort of a question we confront, you know, whether I work in Mustang or I work in other parts of Nepal. But then again, you know, as researchers, our biggest limit, we are always running from post to post to get our research. You know, we have to ask, you know, apply to one request or proposal, we get funded, we don't get funded. You put 20, you get one. That also if you are lucky. And of course, our government doesn't invest in producing generative knowledge in this sense. But I think what you highlighted was a very important point. You know, we have in Nepal at the moment in this whole contradiction between development and environment. You know, there is a school of thought which says, all right, you know, we need development, so therefore we need infrastructure, we need dams, fair enough. We need energy, we need to move, we need commuting, etc. And that argument goes on to say, you know, we can compromise with the environment. We don't need to worry about, you know, ecosystem environment. We can come back again and destroy them anyway. Let's become rich first, and then we'll come back and you know, get things right. But what you suggested was, hey, wait a minute, there is this thing called irreversibility. It might be lost forever. You might not have, you know, what you started with in the first place. So use some sense of precaution. Yeah. Be a little bit sensitive to the, you know, larger context. It's just not the ecosystem. The ecosystem is central. But at the same time, the ecosystem services is linked to society, to people, to livelihood, you know, to culture, you know, to kind of values. I think that your research, you know, in some very comprehensive way, in a period of last so many years, highlights those points. So I think that seems to me is the takeaway from this evening. I'd really like to thank Dr. Byers for, you know, taking his time and, you know, this lecture series. Which one this? This is LLX, I get confused. Huh? 87. You know, this is, I get confused by this. 87th lecture. And then thank you very much, Kavin, for coming. And there is a small token of appreciation from all of us. Here we go.
Okay. Thank you very much.